Hello everyone. In this video, we will talk about otitis media with effusion. Now, otitis media with effusion or OME, it is known by various names: serous otitis media, secretory otitis media or SOM, then mucoid otitis media, and sometimes also called glue ear. So OME, it is collection or accumulation of non-purulent effusion in the middle ear cleft. Now, important point to note here is that the fluid which is collected in the middle ear in OME, it is non-purulent, that is non-infectious. While in acute otitis media or acute suppurative otitis media, the fluid in the middle ear is purulent or it is pus. Now, this OME, it is commonly seen in school-going children, that is up till 5 or 6 years of age. And there are two mechanisms of fluid collection in the middle ear in OME. First one is, either there is malfunctioning of the eustachian tube. Malfunctioning of the eustachian tube can be because of many reasons, and it leads to impaired middle ear aeration. The second mechanism is increased secretory activity of the middle ear mucosa. Now, the malfunctioning of the eustachian tube can be because of any of the following reasons, that is adenoid hyperplasia, chronic rhinitis and sinusitis, it can be because of chronic tonsillitis also, or in adults especially, it can be sometimes because of tumors of the nasopharynx. Also seen in cleft palate and palatal paralysis, in which there is poor tone of the tensor valley palatini muscle. Second mechanism is allergy. Now, in this allergy, the middle ear mucosa acts as a shock organ, and the middle ear mucosa starts secreting fluid which is sterile, which gets collected in the middle ear. Sometimes OME can also be because of unresolved otitis media, that is, if the proper antibiotics are not given either in dose or in amount or in days, then the infection sometimes partially resolves and it leads to formation of OME. Also seen with some viral infections like adeno and rhinoviruses. Now, the most common symptom of OME will be hearing loss. Hearing loss is around 40 decibels, and the parents come with their child complaining that the child is not able to hear properly. And if OME develops very early in life, it can also affect the speech of the child. So the speech can be delayed or defective. Very rarely there can be pain in the ear also. So on otoscopic examination of the ear, the tympanic membrane is seen as dull and opaque, and there is no light reflex seen in the anterior inferior quadrant. Sometimes the tympanic membrane can also be yellowish, grayish or bluish in color. The tympanic membrane may show a bulge or it can be a retracted drum. Sometimes the fluid level and even the air bubbles may be seen if the tympanic membrane is thin. And if we check the mobility of the tympanic membrane, either by Valsalva or by segalization, we know that the tympanic membrane mobility is restricted. In this figure, we can see that air bubbles are clearly seen behind the intact tympanic membrane. So this can be a case of secretory otitis media. So the investigations for OME will be on doing the tuning fork test. It will show a conductive type of hearing loss, where Rene test will be negative, that is bone conduction will be more than ear conduction in the affected ear. The Weber test will be lateralized to the affected ear, and the absolute bone conduction test will be normal. Similar conductive hearing loss will be seen on pure tone audiogram, whereas ear bone gap will be seen. On impedance audiometry, we get a type B curve in otitis media with effusion. And on X-ray mastoid, that is Schuller's view, we see clouding of ear cells, that is collection of fluid in the ear cells, which gives an appearance of clouding of ear cells. Now, this is an audiogram in which of the left ear, in which we see a conductive hearing loss. There is an ear bone gap. So such type of audiogram we get in otitis media with effusion. This is a tympanogram showing type B curve, or flat curve, or sometimes called dome shaped curve. Here there is no identifiable peak in the graph or in the curve. This is seen in any case of fluid in the middle ear like otitis media with effusion. Now the medical management of otitis media with effusion includes use of decongestants, which can be either topical like oxymetazoline, xylometazoline. They are instilled in the nose and they decongest the nasopharyngeal opening of the eustachian tube, or sometimes systemic decongestants are also used like pseudoephedrine, phenylephrine. Then since allergy is also one of the etiology for OME, anti-allergic measures are also taken in the form of antihistaminic drugs and short course of steroids. Steroids can be used topically as well as systemic. Though there is no significant role of antibiotics in OME, but sometimes there is tonsillitis or adenoiditis or rhinitis, sinusitis associated with OME. So to treat that infection, antibiotics may be required. And simultaneously, measures should be taken for to improve the middle ear aeration in the form of Valsalva manure. The patient is asked to perform repeated Valsalva manures. Eustachian tube catheterization can also be done. And the patient is asked to chew gum, which will open the eustachian tube and improve the middle ear ventilation. The surgical treatment includes myringotomy. Now myringotomy, it is putting an incision over the drum to drain the middle ear fluid. Now in this figure here, we see that this figure is of the right ear of the patient, in which we see that a radial incision is placed in the anterior inferior quadrant of the eardrum and a thick glue-like fluid is being aspirated. The instrument used here is Politzer's myringotome. Now sometimes if the fluid is thick, then sometimes two incisions are required. One is in the anterior inferior and another one in the anterior superior quadrant, and that is sometimes called beer can principle. Now when the fluid in the middle ear is very thick, or we want that the myringotomy incision is kept open for a long time, then grommate is also inserted after doing myringotomy. This grommate is also called tympanostomy tube or ventilation tube. This is placed in the myringotomy incision and it acts as a channel for middle ear fluid to drain outside. After 3 to 6 months of insertion, the grommate is expelled on its own. Other modalities of treatment of OME are cortical mastoidectomy, in which all the mastoid ear cells are removed, and because they sometimes the pus or the loculated fluid or the cholesterol granuloma, they are present in the mastoid ear cells which continuously secrete fluid, so they should be removed. And simultaneously the causative factor should also be removed by doing tonsillectomy, by adenoidectomy, and also if there is any sinus or nose infection, so that should also be managed. Now if untreated or if present for a long time, the otitis media with effusion can have the following sequelae. It can either cause atrophy of the tympanic membrane and atelectasis of the middle ear. In this, the middle fibrous layer of the tympanic membrane is dissolved and a thin tympanic membrane is present. Then sometimes it can also lead to ossicular necrosis, in which the most common ossicle to get necrosed is the long process of incus. Then tympanosclerosis, which is the hyalinization of the middle fibrous layer. Hyalinized collagen is present as chalky deposits seen on the tympanic membrane. That can be a sequelae of otitis media with effusion. Then retraction pockets and cholestatoma. If untreated for long time, because of the eustachian tube dysfunction, there is creation of negative pressure in the middle ear, which causes retraction of the tympanic membrane, and ultimately it can lead to formation of cholestatoma. Or it can also lead to granulation tissue in the middle ear cleft, which are sometimes called cholesterol granuloma. So these can be the sequelae of chronic or long-standing secretory otitis media. In this figure, we see a tympanosclerosis. We can clearly see the white patches which are present over most of the part of the tympanic membrane, anterior and posterior and inferior to the handle of malleus. Thank you.